lady.
I heard that.
Oh, there it is.
I'm grounded.
Every freaking week. Seeing the change they made, for me, it's hard for me to even, I think it was two different characters, definitely. But I really enjoyed what they did with it because it gave me more room to work and have fun and really hyped up the dynamic between him and Lionel. And so the more they develop the arc and it even progresses through the series from what's aired so far, it made him a lot more fun and a lot more interesting to play than I thought he would be when I originally began the series. And so I'm excited whenever each script comes because it's like, ooh, how... How twisted is this relationship going to get this time?
Well, it's interesting because Peter Newman, who was laying on the original series, and I have very similar voices. And that was before we knew they were brothers, too. That was a shock, by the way, when I found out. They said, you're playing Claudius, who is the father of Lionel and Tygra. And I went, I want to see that family tree, you know? There's some interspecies thing going on there because, you know, one's a tiger, one's a... Yeah, you know, anyway, let's not get into that. But Peter and I have very similar voices, and so we had to, you know, kind of between the two of us, you know, you go high, I go low, unless you don't like you're plotting a football play or something. But fortunately, Lionel, at the beginning of the original, was younger. And what made me think of that was, well, Matthew, when you said how cocky Tygra was, Lionel at the time was the opposite, because he was still a little in awe of having to lead the whole group, and he did not feel terribly confident. So I could make him a little more, I don't know, snark if I could do this, you know. and then later he became, I can do this, no problem. But that's how we kind of developed. Originally, just basically our first intent was, goal was to make the two voices sound disparate enough that when you heard one and didn't see who was talking, you would know which one it was.
Now on King Claudius, what was the approach that you had on that?
Well, it's been very easy. I've gotten older and my voice has gotten more gravelly. So, you know, when I try to do Lion-O, though, now he's Claudius, you know. Seriously, because this is very gravelly because I've been doing interviews and you know what that's like at the Comic-Cons.
Oh, geez, yeah.
I love this one because it's smaller and confined to just, you know, people, fans of a certain genre.
More personal, harder to get grabbed.
Right, you have more time to talk to the fans. What, I missed what you said?
Oh, it's for the best. Go ahead.
There I go, stepping on somebody's line again. But as you know, like Comic-Con is amazing. I had never been to one until this year. But I'm going to try to figure out how to say this so it doesn't sound like we had to work too hard. But you do, when you do the press interviews, they put you in a room like this. And I'll never forget the first time Warner Brothers asked me in San Francisco, they asked me to do a panel of interviews. I said, fine. So I came in a room like this one, and there were lots of people in the room, but I didn't realize they were all there, you know, with cameras and film crews. So I did about five. You go to one, and you go to the next one, they ask you the same questions. Next one, same questions. And I got to the end over here, and I said, thank you all. And Winston Cito from Warner Brothers says, no, there, we go all the way around the room. So I forget what the original question was, but.
What?
Don't get old, it's a bitch. But people expect less of you. There's less pressure on you. They say, well, Larry's dumb. He might forget things, don't worry about it. But there are good things about that. I mean, you're always meeting new friends. You can hide your own Easter eggs. And I forget the rest of them. But, yeah, doing Claudius, I was serious to some extent in that Lion-O was my voice, basically, as Tygra is Matthew's voice. Now, of course, when I'm sitting here just talking to you, I would say, you know, Sword of Omens, come to my hand, I am Lion-O commanded. When you're acting, it's Sword of Omens, come to my hand, I, you know, it's dramatic. But basically, Lion-O was my voice, as Tygra is Matthew's voice. And now Claudius is my voice, and my natural voice has aged. So it's not really acting. It's just, you know, anybody can do it, but they don't know that.
Yeah, they do now.
Well, I'm dead anyway, so what's the difference?
Okay, working with that, Matthew, I guess
Before the series began, everyone was like, his outfit's different, and he's now, you know, Lion-O's brother, and he has a gun. You ruined the character. And I'm like, I haven't watched it yet. And I'm just doing his voice. I can't change that. I'm sorry. Like, I've actually got, like, people writing up my website and sending me fan mail. I'm sorry to bother you, sir, but what have you done? You know, that kind of thing. And I just kept saying, like, hang on, like, give it a chance. I know, like, when I first read, you know, saw the original designs as a fan of the show as a kid, I was like, am I going to be part of ruining my childhood? I don't know. But thankfully, the show ended up being amazing, and just it's been a better with each episode. So, like, every time I get that little bit of, you know, how do you feel destroying my childhood? And I'm like, I don't, it's not, give it a shot. I'm like, well, I haven't actually watched the show yet. I'm like, well, there's your problem.
And now that they have?
Now that they have, it's been overwhelmingly positive. Yeah, I've gotten a lot of people sending art. And, go tell your friends to watch it. It must go on.
You know, I remember hearing, the first that they were doing the new series. You know, for a couple of years, Warner Brothers talked about a feature film. And then all of a sudden, my agent called and said, they're doing a series and they'd like you to be involved in it. And I remember thinking, after I said, first show me the scripts, I want to see the characters, I'm not going to do anything, it's going to, the original fans are going to say, this sucks. Mm-hmm. I don't want to be a part of it. And I immediately became clear after talking to Jim and the guys at Warner Brothers, Because they all grew up big fans of ThunderCats. All the writers, the directors, the, I don't know about the animators, but I'm sure they did. But I remember thinking, I'm glad I'm not, you know, I've been there with this series, so I know what it's like. But for you guys, I was thinking, it's got to be tough because you're stepping, you know, what you just talked about. And you know there are lots of people like this out there thinking, all right, let's see what you got. You know, oh, yeah. And that's got to be frustrating. We didn't have that, of course, because we came out of the blue. And everybody says, well, he's the perfect lineup. Well, because, yeah, he's the perfect lineup. Well, now there's a standard, you know.
Yeah.
But you certainly met it, and I think surpassed it.
Oh, well, I appreciate that. I just think they recall when we went in to record the first episode. Wilfred Allard is the voice of Lino in the new series. Walks over and we all chat for a little bit. He's like, "So how many episodes are going to come out before the fans come and kill me? Do you think?"
No.
I said, "I don't know. Depends on how well you do in the booth today, buddy." He's done a fantastic job.
He's great. I haven't met him yet either.
Oh, well, we'll have to find a way.
I want to do it. He will email me the nicest email. Just telling me how much it meant to him to be doing that. And I said, think back to him. And I've forgotten again, I swear to God. It's kind of fun, it's like a little vacation. You take like little, I call them senior vacations. Because for that 2 or 3 seconds, I know you're all sitting there going, oh God, is he all right? But I'm off somewhere. Like on a beach, you know? Oh, sorry, what? He does a great job. He sent me a very nice email. Oh, I remember what I wrote back to him. I said, I hope we can get the chance to work together or meet somewhere. And I said, I want you to know I love your lion. You've made him a little cockier, a bit of a smartass. That I, like I always thought he should be anyway, and that was that story. That's it. It's just they can't all be great answers, okay? That's why they have highlight shows. Like here are some highlights of the panel. That wasn't one of them.
That won't be on the reel.
That'll be on YouTube.
It'll be on YouTube. Yeah.
Yes. Do you have a favorite episode from the original series and the new series?
Oh, the original series, I mean, Exodus, like the beginning was just so epic. It was so incredible. That was what originally just threw me into the series as a kid. Out of personal interest, even before I was involved with the new ThunderCats, the Garden of Delight episode with Tygra getting a little freaky-dicky.
Well, I'm glad you finished that sentence. Because I was thinking, I don't remember him getting a little...
Which continues into the new series. But no, like, those are some of my favorites in particular. In the new series, episodes that have aired, I'm a huge fan of Legacy, even though I'm not even in that one. But Legacy has the whole backstory to, like, Mumra and the ThunderCats and their involvement back in the history of Thundera, and then actually has like, hidden Easter eggs. For those that haven't seen it, they have, like, you know, other characters from that childhood era showing up in the same universe, like Monstar, Tiger Sharks. I was like,
no!
Exactly. I was in there for the recording, and I didn't see any of the original artwork, so I didn't watch that episode until it aired. And then I was watching it with my girlfriend Marisha, and we're just like, wait, is that... That was Monstar. Are we going to fight him later on? That's going to suck. But that one was fantastic. I do have a couple of really favorite episodes that haven't aired yet, about mid-season, and they're pretty cool.
That's all he can say, or they'll kill him. They, yep. Warner Brothers, they'll kill us.
No, they
no, I'm serious.
The first day we went in to record, they patted us on the back, and we felt this little pain in our neck, and it's like, oh, it's just the chip we implanted, don't worry about it. They can remotely detonate it.
So you saw a Monstar in that too, because I thought I was having an acid flashback. Well, I'm not, from the 60s, you know. And,
I'm not discounting that either, but...
I think it couldn't... The two are not mutually exclusive. Yeah, it could have been both.
I mean, you were actually watching episode 3, so could very well have been.
Interesting, interestingly enough, I can't buy these through the mail. You got to go and have them fitted. Exodus is my favorite one too. I think probably because it was the first episode, and we were so excited to start recording it back then. You know, back in 1927, and it was all black and white then. Did you know that the original was no? And it wasn't on TV. You would buy a flip book, and there's Lionel. But yeah, Exodus is, I think, has been my favorite too. Interesting, because I don't think I could ever have a favorite episode that I wasn't in. That's just my ego, I guess.
Well, that's good to know. Okay, Matthew, if you were doing this, what other field would you be working in?
Street performer? No. Interests from this, I mean, outside of the entertainment industry would be more the way, because if it was a voiceover, I'd be doing film and, you know, writing. I do a lot of writing as well, so I have different elements, but it's all entertainment related. If it had to be outside of the entertainment industry, I'd probably be a teacher. I love teaching. I love the idea of influencing and shaping the minds of today's youth, and just to become better people. And because I feel there's a lot of that teacher students, I don't know, that's going to sound awful, so the intimacy, not the way you think, but like, but I feel there's a disconnect between the way teachers and students interact these days, and I would like to try and bring a little bit more of that back to the classroom. And yeah,
well, teachers are the true superheroes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Definitely.
But in a way, you will be shaping young people's minds, because that's what people have told me, that our show was so huge in their lives, and helping them, especially to go to Thunder and things like that.
Shame mine.
Yeah. Are you going to ask me the same question? Ask it the same way, because I have a funny answer. This is great. I guess that's a kick out of myself.
So if you were working in this field, what would you be doing?
Working in a field. You know, picking strawberries. That's funny. I promise. I'm going to write that. Next SuperCon, I'm going to write that down. I'm telling the moderator, ask me what I'm doing. I have no idea. But I started radio when I was 15 years old. It's a disc jockey. And did little funny voices and characters on my show and stuff. And I was class clown, believe it or not. So I've always kind of been... had the need to entertain people, and the need, you know, look at me, how funny am I? In fact, I often think back, I wish I had a nickel. Well, I do have a nickel for every teacher who said to me at some point or other, you know, Mr. Kenney, I hope when you grow up you find a way to make a living from your little voices and your jokes. I did. But you are, through this show, shaping young minds. And there's more money than the teaching.
Well, depends. Depends on if the show continues.
Oh, it will. It will.
I hope so. It's so fantastic.
Yes.
But it's all up to you guys, you know.
We're all canceled.
That's right. We can threaten them.
That always works, right?
We have the weapons.
Yeah.
We have Mama Ron.
Now, in recording your voices, it's like, how difficult is it to lip flap?
I like that.
Versus lip flap. Straight recording from the radio.
Well, I began my voiceover career in Japanese animation. So I have a lot of experience with lip flap before this.
Thank you, Suwato.
I will say it's much more difficult and technical to follow lip flap, which we do for ADR. On episodes, when they come back to the animation and they're like, been changes made to the scripts, or maybe you do additional lines that were added in the hindsight. And it's because it's layering both focusing on the performance and the character's drive and that moment and everything, and then layering on top of that very, very technical aspect of matching timing and beats and the way the mouth is moving. So it's more difficult. I find it personally a lot more freeing to doing original prelay animation where you're. It's all based on your performance. You can have the flexibility to deliver however you feel it's meant to be delivered. And it just feels more pure, more interesting. So I like both processes, but Falling Lip Hop is definitely much more technical and not quite as, it's not quite as freeing.
I laugh because I never heard the expression lip flap before. No, I'm serious. Lip sync, we call it.
Yeah.
Is that the new expression, lip flap?
It can be. There are multiple expressions.
I thought you would, I laughed because I thought that how cute it was, and you meant lip sync when you said lip flapping.
No, obviously it was like lip flap slash sync.
Yeah, okay, good.
For it was for both you. I wasn't sure if you also had to.
We did. Well, very rarely did we lip, what we called lip syncing then. We always record, as with most animation, I assume it's still the same. You guys do the voices first, and then the animators do the voices.
Yes.
Yeah, of course. It's very difficult the other way. Almost not impossible, but it's so time-consuming. You record the voices first, then the animators animate to the voice. If you do it the other way around, and it's already animated, first of all, you lose the ability to if you have to your vocal acting has to match. However they decided to animate it in terms of, you know, your gestures and things, it's very limiting for you. But when you do the acting part first, the amount of rage you have or how quietly you're speaking and whatever you're doing, then they can animate to those emotions. It's also, we always work together. You guys all work together?
Yeah.
People have asked me that, because when I come out, unfortunately I work alone, I didn't get a chance to meet you guys. But I saw your microphones all lined up. So you're all there and you're working, but occasionally, let's say something from a show that's hasn't gone on the air yet, it's been animated, but a line has been changed for whatever reason, legal reasons, or
sometimes it comes back and, you know, you deliver the line very much like, all right, line, now I got this, and the animation comes back and you're like 2 miles apart, like,
yeah.
I want to make it a little louder, you know.
Sometimes it was even grunts and groans. Mm-hmm. We need more in there, you know.
What cartoon does that mean?
I used to tell him, just go get an X-rated movie and take the sound.
He's done a lot of those, so it's easy to pull for all.
You've seen them, have you?
I torrented them.
No big thing.
Matthew, I heard that you like writing. Do you have any interest in writing a book?
Writing a book. I grew up reading a lot of fiction, a lot of like sci-fi and fantasy fiction. Isaac Asimov, Piers Anthony. I don't know if I have the writing style for full-on books per se. My interest is more towards screenwriting, writing for animation, or writing for film. And I'm actually in the process right now of putting together a couple of spec scripts for the new ThunderCats. We'll see if they like them or not. But I'm as part of my writing interest, I would like to be part of that as well. I know Will Friedle, who does the voice of Lando, has actually co-written and written a few episodes. It's kind of nice to have some cast interaction as well. Those of us who do have a writing disposition to be possibly given a chance to be part of the creative process.
Wow. They wouldn't even let me write notes in the margins of my script. Read the words.
Larry, for the new series episodes, especially the first episode, there was a sword duel between father and son. Who wins in the real-life sword duel between Larry Kenney and Will Friedle?
Well, Larry Kenney is 64 years old. Will is 11. I would actually bet on Will.
Plus,
No comment.
Smart man. You'll be writing books.
Okay, this is for both of you. Have you seen the toy line? And if you have the original love for comparison, which one is?
People always ask. Now listen. Can I just give you a little hint?
Yes.
Buy boxes of these. Don't open them and keep them. Because 30 years from now, you're going to be sitting here saying, I forgot the question. But I have boxes of these toys beside you. So I don't have. I pay people to remind me. My son asks me all the time. He's 23 and a Republican, so he just wants all the money in the world. He says, you know, Dad, these toys on eBay, you know, $50 for anything. And if you could sign it, it'd be worth, you know, $52. Why didn't you? Well, who knew? Who knew we were going to, you know?
I will learn from your mistake.
Yes,
my sensei.
I get 10%.
We'll talk.
The figures are great, though. And you know what? I did it in San Diego. I did a 2-hour signing for Bandai. And people were bringing the box after box of the new Lionel. And then somebody brought one, I think, is that the classic Lionel? They also made a new classic Lionel that people were bringing to me to sign. I thought, well, that's nice. They did an homage to, you know, the old Lionel, too. I think the new toys are good. They're great. The old ones, they look like they're 30 years old. Wow, that's a huge one.
Thank you.
No, I hadn't seen that one. That's incredible. You know, I remember, I like telling the story, do I have time? Just to tell quick. People are always asking, when did you know that the show was a big hit back then, you know? Well, first of all, we started recording in 83, didn't go on until 85. Now it's been only a year. You know, you hear from the people, because we went on to do Silverhawks, Tigers, all of us with the same director, Lee Doniger. So we worked together a lot. Then we did 6 Rankin-Bass Christmas specials. A Star for Jeremy, 12 Days of Christmas, Life and Adventure in the Santa Claus. So, my point is, for 4 or 5 years, we were working together a lot, you know. And I remember, so we were getting feedback, you know, the shows, the ratings are great. And I remember it was about 2 weeks before Christmas, probably in 86, I walked into Toys R Us to do some Christmas shopping. And it's like there was music. There were 3 aisles of nothing but ThunderCats toys. And I thought, this thing's huge. It was last week, it was Ninja Turtles. Now they took them out, it's a Ninja Turtle, whatever, you know. And I'll never forget, as I'm walking down the aisles looking at all this stuff, there are 2 boys, maybe 10, 12 years old, and I can overhear them as I walk by. And one of them says, I'm going to get Panthro. He's the coolest. And the kid says, I don't know, I might get one of the mutants. So I just, you know, I go over and I say, why don't you get Lionel? He's the one who says, ThunderCats, ho! I'm thinking they'd be thrilled. And of course they look at me like, come on, perv. Now, as I'm walking away, I'm kind of chuckling myself, and I heard one say to the other, it didn't even sound like Lionel. I stopped in my tracks and I'm laughing. And I had to actually force myself not to turn around and say, you little shit. If you only knew, you'd crap your pants. I thought it was so funny. He didn't even sound like Lionel. To this day, I thought if that kid knew Lionel just said that, I mean, you know. But he never will. It's true. I don't remember if it's actually true. I'm pretty sure it's true. You can't make that kind of stuff up.
Okay, this is the time we'll be opening questions for the audience, for the guests.
My question is for Matthew. You said that you started in the Japanese animation. How did you kind of get into that and then cross over to voiceover work here in the U.S.?
Well, the voiceover animation was recorded in the U.S. for the Japanese animation when they brought it over to English. So I was still home. I haven't yet to go to Japan yet. I want to go badly. It sounds like a really cool time. But that's what I hear. It's in, you know, drunken karaoke. Woo!
Tygra!
I mean, when I'm old enough.
You'll never be old enough. Why can't you be more like your brother?
Just wait till next season. I began doing Japanese animation shortly out of high school through some just strange series of coincidences and meeting friends and getting to meet a director who said, like, I like your voice. You ever thought about doing this? Going in and doing background voices in Walla for Fist of the North Stars, like, you know, 3 hours of heads exploding, you know, things like that. And then just transitioned over into video game voiceover through that, got an agent, began really hitting the pavement hard like you got to do as an actor in Los Angeles, and just kept getting more work, then started moving over into animation. And actually, ThunderCats is my first major American animation project I've had a lead character in, and it's a dream come true.
That a little bit, yeah.
I didn't feel like it's for both you guys. Like, well, it's really great having the first episode, it's a passing of the course.
Yeah, I thought it was a nice touch for Warner Brothers to do an homage. It was for the fans, yeah.
Yeah.
I think it was Warner Brothers saying, don't worry, it's going to be, you know, the old show that you love.
That's right.
Like, how did it feel to like the episode of Claudius?
Well, thank you. Well, it's art imitating life, because, or the other way around, because I actually was passing the sword on, not just to Lionel, but I took it upon myself to feel as though for the rest of my friends, the rest of the original cast, we were saying to you guys, take it and do well with it, you know. I remember when they flew me out here to record at Warner Brothers Ranch, that scene where Claudius dies. Well, of course, I had read the script and I knew what was going on, but Andrea, our wonderful director, she reminds me so much of Lee Doniger. She works the same way. That she's just so good. She'll say, okay, that was good. That was very good. Let's go to line 86. Now, up until this point, I had, you know, this and that. And then there were battle scenes, right? And I knew what was coming, of course. She says, now, Larry, you know, line 82. Just, okay, a little stronger grunts. And now you're swinging the, okay, fine. Now, line 86. And I knew that was the line. It's over. Feel her, hear her, kind of just, she was a little hesitant. She says, okay, now, Larry, and she's in the other room through the glass. Okay, Larry, now, in this one, you're stabbed in the back. And this is the mess with her, I said. Oh, okay, so I'm stabbed in the back, but I survive. And I see the engineer go, and poor Andrea, she's like, she says, no. I said, okay. Thank you. But her face, poor thing. I survived, right?
From my perspective, as soon as I learned that I was going to be part of the project, I went into storage and dug out my old Tygra action figure that I'd forgotten that I had, to put that on my desk as like a reminder of what was coming up, and so I read the script and everything. And
I thought maybe you held him up while you talked.
that's more of my alley. How do you know about that? But so we went in to record for the first time, and it was interesting to watch us all establish the personalities as during the first record. Because all of us read the script, but we weren't quite sure how each of us were going to be performing it. And I believe you had already recorded for the first episode when we got in there, because we were able to hear your dialogue to play off of. And when we got to that scene with Will, I remember it just got really like somber and intense, and we all began to realize the weight that the series was really going to carry with its storytelling. Because as much as you read a good script, it isn't until you hear the actual performance that you realize the gravity of how this is going to affect the children that watch it. And that was that moment we realized, like, we had something really, really amazing on our hands. The way that Will played off of your lines, and then especially when it came back for ADR and seeing the final scene animated, it was like, this is going to be intense.
Yeah. Andrea told me that the next time I came out, she said that Will, the first time he was supposed to say in the script, the first time ever, thunder, she said he kind of went, hang on a second.
Yeah.
She said, I knew he was like, this has got to be right.
It was great. So watching him go weak at the knees.
Yeah.
It was like, I can't do it. And then Kevin Richardson, who just the voice of Panther, was off to the side. And we're like, sing it! We don't want to hear you say it! And he finally says it, we're all like, oh, I need a cigarette. Yeah, it was a culmination. It was a wondrous culmination at that point.
That's funny. You're the moderator. Get in line, throw them out.
Matt, in There Will Be Brawl, is that all you and Kirby Lecter?
Yes, for those who aren't familiar, I directed and produced a web series a few years ago called There Will Be Brawl. It's a live action film noir kind of adult crime drama. It takes place in the Nintendo universe. So it's like all Nintendo characters, but they're all very dark and very like HBO. Adult, messed up, twisted characters. But yeah, I voiced Kirby throughout the entire series. And he was a very like, interesting, liberal sort of character. So, yeah, cool. But I see there's some fans of the series in here. That makes me happy. My parents said wouldn't let me own toy guns. I was allowed to own toy swords at the wazoo, so I was kind of fell into my high fantasy, you know, love growing up. I was like, swords and sorcery, magic, yay! But I was never allowed to own a gun of any kind of toy sword. Even like water guns were like, well, it's bright orange and has a happy face on it, maybe. So at first when they showed me the art and the designs for the character and the new ideas, I was like, that's different. But also, I think it plays an interesting aspect for the character. While everyone else has, for the most part, you know, it's an energy pistol, and you know, it doesn't actually, you know, see anyone's head explode or anything. But still, the symbol, I understand what you're saying. I think it's an interesting variation, the fact that Tygra, especially in the new series, is very different from the other Thundercats. His personality is a little darker. He comes from a darker place, a place of rejection from both his, you know, he feels rejected from his family, and you know, kind of living in the shadow of his brother. And I think the pistol addition to him gave him this sort of, you know, as the darker character, he's falling more towards the technological side anyway, you know, that Mama represents, and that's kind of the ride that he's, you know, the line that he's riding as a character. So I think, for symbolically, I don't think it's so much promoting the use of guns as a character more than it's showing that the tech pistol that he uses shows that he's leaning a little closer to that dark side, the bad guy's side, than the other characters. And so I there is, of course, some concern, but also it's a sign of the times, too. Exactly. I mean, if he was, like, you know, loading up a six-shooter with, like, bullets, and like, I'm going to take out Mummer in the forehead, I'd be like, I don't know if I'm comfortable recording this. But also, the first few episodes were a bit pistol-heavy, as Tygra was really happy to have his new gun. He's like, oh, this thing's cool, I'm going to shoot everything in front. Now they're doing more of a pistol-whip combination, almost like a Indiana Jones sort of Devil May Cry style of, like, stylized using the bows, which is kind of cool, so. But, yeah, that was a little bit of a concern at the beginning, but I think they're playing it in a way that's not too overtly, you know, ThunderCats extreme!
Well, that was a great answer. I think you actually won this guy over.
Really? We shall see.
Oh, yes. Earl Hammond, Mum-Ra, rest his soul. Earl Hammond, rest his soul. Mum-Ra, ever living.
Yeah.
The funniest thing is that Earl would become Mum-Ra to the extent that...
He brought a costume.
He actually brought a... No, that's the way he dressed then. He dressed then. But you know how Mum-Ra drools this... green. When Earl did the thing, we would, when we, people would be looking at, you know, when's his next big ancient spirits of evil coming up? Oh, and people would start moving toward the side of the room. Because he would go, ancient spirit of evil! And he would start drooling. And he would wipe it and he'd go, transform the future!
It's like a Gallagher concert with a splash zone.
Yeah. I never knew if he did it on purpose or it just happened. But he would be literally transformed. And sometimes he would go, transform. Did I get you? He was a wonderful man. Funny, funny guy. And Bob McFadden has passed, snark.
Larry, what have you done since Transformers that you particularly liked?
I never did Transformers.
I'm sorry.
That's
I'm sweet.
That I particularly liked? Well, I just love working and being in the business. We did Silverhawks, we did Tiger Sharks, we did Comic Strip, which was 2 hours every Saturday morning, 4 shows, Karate Cat, Three Frogs, and 2 others. We did 5 or 6 Rankin-Bass Christmas specials. I think I mentioned that a little while ago. And I've been the voice of Count Chocula for over 30 years. Frightfully delicious cereal. Bob McFadden, by the way, was Frankenberry. With strawberry flavored marshmallows. And I've been sucking the Cocoa Puffs bird for 33 years. You know. Oh, here, I want more Cocoa for Cocoa Puffs! Thank you. I've been honored, so lucky to do so many things. For 35 years, I was on the cast of I Miss in the Morning, a radio TV show. I was Best Week Ever. You remember Best Week Ever on VH1? It's the first week of February 2010, the best week ever! That was me. I use that voice now on Skittles commercials. I'm the guy that says, feel the rainbow, taste the rainbow. I'm so busy, you know. I keep busy.
Yeah.
You gotta eat. But my kids, the last of my children that I know of, well, I'm in show business, you know.
And you travel a lot.
Yeah, it's I have 3 children, one of each. And my youngest son just graduated from NYU. My oldest daughter graduated from NYU. My middle daughter graduated from Oxford. Thank you, ThunderCats. Not Oxford, England. Oxford of Connecticut. Nice. So, I'm still working. I ain't going yet.
Spinny dies.
Now that would be YouTube.
Like,
I'm still around anyway.
Give me that tape.
These comic cons are such a drag. Listen to Matthew drag Larry. Any more questions? I think we're about out of time, aren't we? Well, somebody has. No. Nor did they the first time around. No, either. No, because, and rightly so, because they had the world, they had fantastic writers as they do now. Directors, they, these people know what they're doing. We're actors. That's just we talk. Looking back, I think probably once in a while something would come up. What do you guys think? Should you be doing? But no, mostly, the script was written, you do this script. Now, there were times when you might say, after you had been Lando for a while, you knew they couldn't replace you. You might say, how about instead of he says, I would rather, how about he just says, I'd rather not do that? Things like that, you know. Yeah. Maybe Lionel would say it this way, and they might say, yeah, I think you're right. But nothing major. You don't say, well, I think this page should be out. Or, no. I don't know how it is now.
No, it's exactly like that. We just start taking pages out. Well, no, this is the chip, remember? We can't do anything. Well,
So if you even tried to say it, it would just click.
Yeah, it's a little taser. Sorry. Wow. Sorry.
That's cool. Get my wife one of those. I love her. I said the other day, there's so few things about her that annoy me. If you could find somebody that you're married to for 40 years that only a few things annoy you, that may. So I said, but there's one, I always wondered, why do you always answer my questions with a question? She looks at me, she says, do I do that?